Good morning, Third Coast Church. Happy 4th of July. Let's stand to our feet and let's worship our God this morning. God who evermore will be. He opened the prison doors, He parted the raging seas. Our God, He holds the victory. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. Shout out your praise. There's joy in the house. Surely it is too late, and we won't be quiet. We shout out your praise. We shout out your praise. We sing to the God who heals. We sing to the God who saves. We sing to the God who always makes a way. On that cross, then He rose up from that grave. My God still rolling stones away. There's joy in the house of the Lord. There's joy in the house of the Lord today. And we won't be quiet. Shout out your praise. There's joy in the house of the Lord. Our God is surely in this place.
Good morning. Welcome to Third Coast Church. Yeah. Woo. There we go. All right. Hey, first of all, happy Independence Day. Happy July 4th. We are so glad that you joined us today on this wonderful holiday. We are so blessed to live in a country where we are free to worship God whenever we want to and however we want to. That is a real blessing that is not available everywhere. And there's so much freedom in loving the Lord and following the Lord Himself and being able to cast our sin, our doubt, our burdens on Jesus and know that He has already taken care of those for us. So I would encourage you to dwell on that today as you think about your independence and your freedom, not only in this country, but freedom in Christ. If it's your first time here today, again, welcome. We'd encourage you to fill out one of those connection cards that's in your seat. If you fill that out for us and drop it in the little black box on your way out the door, that's just a way for us to get a hold of you in the event that you'd like to hear more about our church and hear more about what we've got going on outside of church, different events, or how we do childcare, or our community groups, which if you haven't heard about them yet, just community is a way that we meet outside of church, but not on a Sunday, and we do life together, we study the Bible together, and we really just create wonderful, close family-style relationships with individuals in our church outside of a Sunday morning. So again, thank you so much for being here.
Yes. Today, Joe and Mel are actually celebrating their 20th wedding anniversary this week, so yay. I'm glad they're getting that much-needed rest. But today, we have a special guest. Pastor Corey is here to preach today. We're so excited. Right. We're so thankful that you and Kara, we're thankful that you're here with us today. So I'm going to go ahead and pray for us, and then we'll continue to worship. God, thank you so much for today. Thank you for what today represents. God, thank you for the freedom of being able to live in a country where we can worship you and love you. Lord, we're thankful for this church. We just pray that Corey would be able to speak through you to us today, whatever we need to hear. And God, we just pray that you would just be in this place today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever breathe, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. Peace. to those around me. Amen.
Lord, I confess, bowing here, I find my rest. Without you, I fall apart. You're the one that guides my heart. Lord, I need. My one defense, my righteousness, oh God, how I need you. Where sin runs deep, your grace is more. Where grace is found is where you are, and where you Lord, I am free. Holiness is Christ in me. Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my oh God, how I need you. So teach my song to rise to you. When temptation comes my way, and when I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. Jesus, you're my hope and Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you. My one defense, my oh God, how I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh God, how I need you.
Amen. Church, will you pray with me? God, we love you. And we're so thankful for this church and the people here. God, we're just grateful for who you are and all that you give us and the blessings that you give us. God, in these remaining moments of worship, I just pray that each and every one of us can fully give you your praise and give it all to you, because you always give your all to us. In your name we pray. Amen.
Like a ring of solid gold, like a law that is tested, like a covenant of old. And your love is enduring through the winter rain and beyond the horizon, with mercy for today. And it's why I sing your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips. Your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips.
God is true. This is how he loves us.
And you father the orphan, your kindness makes us whole. You shoulder our weakness and your strength becomes our own. Now you're making me like you, clothing me in white, bringing beauty from ashes. For you will have your bride, free of all her guilt, and rid of all her shame, and known by her true name. And it's why I sing your praise. Ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips, your praise will ever be on my lips, ever be on my lips, your praise.
Pray for us one more time before we get into the message today. God, thank you so much for who you are, God, that there are so many reasons that we can praise you, that there are so many reasons that our hearts can sing to you. God, that you are good, that you are powerful, that you are mighty, that you are gentle and lowly in heart towards us. So many things, God, and we're just grateful that we serve a God who is so different from all of our expectations, so much better than anything that we can picture, that we can imagine, that we could have made up ourselves. And so, Lord, we thank you. God, I thank you for your word and the truth and the honesty and the relatability that's in it. And God, I just pray that you would use your word today. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. Well, thank you guys so much for being here today. I am not using a laptop because I'm fancy. I'm using a laptop because I don't own a printer. So, my name is Corey Atkinson. I'm really excited to be with you guys today. I actually grew up with Pastor Joe, so to speak, and so I was born and raised here in Corpus. I worked for Pastor Joe, and so I was in student ministry with him for a long time, and so it's really a unique relationship for me, because really any chance of preaching or leadership that I had was because Pastor Joe gave me a shot, and so I'm really thankful for that. So like, if today goes poorly in any way, that's also Pastor Joe's fault, because I grew up under his leadership. So I grew up here, like I said, but I was gone from Corpus for about 7 years. I lived in Georgia, and I lived in Florida for a year. But my wife and I are back, and so I'm really excited about what God's doing here. We're going to be helping start a campus with BT Church, and so, you know, really excited to connect with Joe and Third Coast and the things that God's already doing here. Like I said, I am married. My wonderful wife, Kara, in the fancy hat over there. We have been married a little over 3 years. We have one cat, no kids, and a strong desire for a German Shepherd. So hopefully that will happen at some point soon. We'll see about that, though. Fun facts about me. Let's just get this out of the way. I once bruised my shoulder bone trying to learn how to break dance in my mom's living room. That's worth noting. My cat knows how to flush the toilet. Really. Like, does it all the time, which is very exciting. And one fun fact is that I love like cheesy monster movies, creature movies, okay? So I've seen Sharknado 1, 2, and 3 probably multiple times, you know? So in case there was any part of you that was like, man, this guy's cool, you can just let that die now. But this love of monsters started when I was young. Like, I don't know what got it going, but Jaws has been my favorite movie since I was a kid. And I was always fascinated with these sort of myths and these sort of weird concepts out there that most people would be like, that's ridiculous. Like, those are, why even look into it? But for me, when I was a kid, I was so into it. So one of the things that I looked up often was the Loch Ness Monster. All right, so I literally was the kid in middle school. I would go to the library and I would find the books on the Loch Ness Monster, and I would sit in the middle of the aisles in the library and read them. Before we had streaming services and all that, I would go onto YouTube and watch documentaries about these crazy people that claim that they saw the Loch Ness Monster, but they're also like not all there. So, you know, maybe it was legit, maybe it was completely ridiculous. But again, for me, like, I was hooked. I believed this thing was in there. There's still a part of me that's not sure. I believed that it was in there. I believed that it was real despite everyone else's unbelief. Another one was Bigfoot, all right? My brother, I have a twin brother, and we used to stay up until like 1 in the morning, 2 in the morning, watching this show called Finding Bigfoot. And it is exactly what it sounds like. It is a bunch of guys who are really smart and probably do a lot of drugs looking for Bigfoots all over the country. And so it's this very elaborate thing. But again, you know, maybe it's the most elusive creature in all of the planet, or maybe these guys are just crazy. Either way, I watched it. Right? Then if you grew up here in South Texas, then you probably have heard of the goat sucker, the chupacabra. And so that was another one. All right, I was like, okay, this is, I don't know, but like, I really think this is real. So I would go and watch these things on YouTube, and I was trying to figure this stuff out because I was always fascinated in these things that most people would say, yeah, that is completely ridiculous, right? Most people doubted the myths, but I believed. Now, I bring that up for a reason, because I realized that, like, as I grew up and as I watched people grow up and grow up in their faith and just in life in general, I realized that it's not just these sort of myths and monsters that we used to believe in that have switched to unbelief, right? There's things in life. Sometimes our beliefs about God, our beliefs about the promises of God, we used to hold really tightly. We believed in those despite, if anyone around us said, that's ridiculous, that's not true, we could just shrug it off because we believed that those were true. But somewhere along the way, we may have hit a snag in the road. We may have experienced something that we thought, man, this doesn't seem to line up with God's promises. Maybe life took a sideways turn. Maybe we talked to some people that challenged our faith intellectually and we started getting a lot of questions, and all of a sudden, as we've grown up, we say, I just don't know if I can have the same belief in God that I used to. Now, for the purpose of this message, I'm not necessarily talking to those that have said, you know, I followed God at one time and now I don't believe, right? I want to more talk to those of us like me who we love God, we follow God, but because of some of the things we've experienced, there's just that part of us that sometimes has doubts. There's sometimes that part of us that what we believe here doesn't quite translate here. And I want to talk about that because in Mark chapter 9, we see a story of this dad, this desperate dad who's trying to deal with his son who has had this destructive, dangerous demon for a long time. And so this dad is dealing with some doubt because of his prolonged pain and prolonged suffering. And so let's look at Mark chapter 9 today. I'm going to start in verse 14, and then I'm going to eventually work my way down to verse 27, a couple verses, you know, in and out here and there. It's one of my favorite passages in all of Scripture. So I want to read verse 14 up to 22 so we can kind of set it up, see what is happening in this story, and then from there I want to kind of go through and see how this thing resolves. So Mark chapter 9, verse 14, it says, "When they came to the disciples, they saw a large crowd around them and scribes disputing with them." Now, let me back up, just quick context. Jesus and some of his closest crew were up on the mountain. They just had this crazy experience called the Transfiguration where they got to see Jesus in his glory and like Moses appeared in the clouds. Crazy experience. Now they're coming back down from the mountain and they're walking into like a hot mess. So that's what's happening. So as they come down from the mountain, they catch up with the disciples. There's a large crowd around and the disciples and the scribes are arguing with each other. Awesome. So Jesus asked them, "What are you arguing with them about?" Essentially, he's like, "Seriously, guys, what? I'm coming down from this great experience, and of course you're down here arguing, right? Just like in the book of Exodus, you know, Moses disappears for a little bit, and he comes down, and they're all worshiping like a golden calf." And so he's like, "I just can't leave." So he comes down, says, "What are you arguing about?" And then someone from the crowd answered him. This is the character of our story. He says, "Teacher, I brought my son to you. He has a spirit that makes him unable to speak. Whenever it seizes him, it throws him down and he foams at the mouth, grinds his teeth, and becomes rigid. I asked your disciples to drive it out, but they couldn't. So they brought the boy to him. When the spirit saw Jesus, it immediately threw the boy into convulsions. He fell to the ground and rolled around, foaming at the mouth." "How long has this been happening to him?" Jesus asked his father. "From childhood," he said, "and many times it has thrown him into fire or water to destroy him." So again, interesting story. And we see the problem set up, right? That this dad's son is possessed by a dangerous and destructive demon. The disciples can't drive it out. And the scribes don't really want to, right? The scribes are there to say, "Hey, we'd just rather argue." And the disciples just can't seem to make this work. And this is interesting because if you're this dad, you're probably frustrated, right? Because you would think, okay, I got this really bad situation, right? My son has a demon, and so who's the people you would go to? The religious leaders, right? So you're like, okay, I'll go to the really smart, astute, well-known religious leaders, or I'm going to go to the people that are walking around with Jesus because Jesus has been doing miracles. So those are the two groups you would think to go to, and yet neither one of them are doing anything to help this situation. So thankfully, Jesus, in his wisdom and providence, comes down the mountain at the perfect time to swoop in and make everything all right. So Jesus walks in. He's like, "All right, you guys are arguing, you're bickering, do your thing, let me know who wins. I'm going to take care of what's happening over here with this dad." And so as this dad is explaining the situation, again, he's probably explaining through tears. He's probably explaining through, you know, he's trying to catch his breath. Like, this is a very difficult, traumatic situation. And so Jesus walks up, he explains it, and then he goes in for the ask, all right? So the dad finally says, "Okay, I've explained it. These guys can't help. These guys can't help. One last Hail Mary, right? I'm gonna shoot it out there and see what happens." And so he says, "But if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us. Explains it all and says, look, no one seemed to help up until now, but man, if you can do anything, if there is some level of compassion in you, if you have the ability to help, then please do that. Just honestly puts it out there. And Jesus says to him, if you can, everything is possible for the one who believes. Verse 24, it says, immediately the father of the boy cried out, I do believe, help my unbelief. I love that sentence so much. I do believe, but help my unbelief. And like I said, this is one of my favorite passages in the New Testament because I can see myself in it, right? There are times where, you know, I see the Apostle Paul and like, you know, he's going around doing all these mission trips, saving all these people. Or you see Peter and I think it's Acts 10, right, where he's walking by and like people are getting healed just from his shadow, you know? He's got like a sweat rag from preaching and you know, he's just got to toss it on people and they're getting healed. And I'm like, that's never going to happen to me, right? And you don't want that to happen either because that's gross. But in this situation, I see it and I go, oh, wow, this is me, right? I can relate to this person as they have strong belief, but they also have those doubts. And so I love this because of that. And I also love it because of the honesty and the vulnerability that this guy displays, right? He's just honest. He just says, look, if you can help, I'm not even sure at this point, but if you can, please have compassion on us. Now, again, not only up until this point has he had the disappointment of Jesus's disciples not being able to help, the scribes not wanting to help, but he says that this has been happening since childhood. Right, so I don't know how old this kid is, but the idea is that he's not a kid anymore, right? So this has been going on for a very, very long time. So if you think about that, maybe you've had that situation. Maybe you've had a person in your family that has gone through an illness. Maybe you have had a spouse that you are hoping will get saved and experience the grace of God. Maybe you, I don't know what that is, but it's been going on for a long time, and they're starting to go, man, I don't know, is this going to change ever, right? Is this going to happen? Now, again, he's going to Jesus anyway, right? He's just saying, look, I'm just going to hope that this is going to work. But it's honest. It's vulnerable. It's not faith-filled necessarily. Now, another thing that I find is interesting is not only there's a part of him that goes, man, I'm not sure if Jesus can, right? So he's struggling with this idea of Jesus's ability to heal, but he also appeals to Jesus's compassion. And so I wonder, this is speculation, but I wonder if there's a part of him that's going, hey, even if I know you can, do you want to? Do you really want to heal? I think about the leper earlier in the gospel account of Mark. There's a leper in Mark chapter 2, and he's talking to Jesus, and he says, if you are willing, you can make me clean. So in this story, the leper is going, I know you can, but are you willing? Right? And so you see these two sides of the coin, ability and willingness. And I don't know where this dad falls on that spectrum, but I would think that he's probably struggling with a little bit of both, right? Can God and will God heal? Regardless, though, he says, I do believe, help my unbelief. Now, let's acknowledge the obvious here, right? Which is that this phrase, as great as it is, as much as I like it, it sounds contradictory at first, right? Because essentially what he's saying is, I have belief, but help my lack of belief. It doesn't seem like it quite matches up. I have belief. I believe, but I don't believe. And so it seems like he is contradicting himself, but what I think is happening is he is explaining and voicing a tension that a lot of us feel at times, right? And the tension is that there's a gap between our knowledge of God and our trust in God. Right? There's a gap there. We know a lot, but how much do we trust and believe? Right? Does our theology and the way we think about God line up with our spirituality and the way that we walk with God regularly? That's what's happening here. God, I believe up here, but man, I'm struggling in here. There's a gap that is going on in my heart. Now, again, I think for all of us, we have had times where we've had that same feeling before, right? We've had those times where we go, God, I know that you have a good plan for my life, but man, I'm having a hard time seeing that in this season. God, I know you called us to this venture, whatever that may be, but I didn't know a pandemic was going to be a part of it. We have these things where we end up with these question marks between what we know and what we truly trust. But here's the thing. Here's the good news of this, is that if you have felt that, congratulations, you're normal. Because sanctification, right, which is the process of us becoming more like Christ, I think a definition for sanctification could be the process of belief moving from your head to your heart. Right? That's a lot of life. A lot of life is we learn things about God through his word, but then the Holy Spirit has to help move those things to our hearts where we really trust and we walk in that truth. That's just a part of our lives. So if you feel like you're on that journey, that's awesome, because the Holy Spirit is probably working in your life, trying to grow you more into the image of Christ. Right? You could say it like this, that life is a continual process of the Spirit of God making us more like the Son of God by moving the words of God from our heads to our hearts. Right? That is it sort of encapsulates this experience of growing in Christ. And it is a beautiful thing, is an exciting thing, and at times, like this dad, it can be a frustrating or tense thing. But again, there's good news in this story. There's so much good news here, because I love the fact that this guy is so honest. Here's two things that he does not do. All right, this is oftentimes my response and probably your response, right? We want to do one of two things. When we're going through something and our lives are tough or our faith is tested, we either want to fake it or we want to fix it, right? I'm either going to fake it and I'm going to be good. I'm going to come to church. I'm going to put on a smile. I'm still going to pray my normal prayers. I'm certainly not going to be honest with God and tell him how I'm really feeling or what's going on, like the Psalms do. I'm going to push those aside. Or we just want to fix it, right? Like, there's no part of us that just wants to throw ourselves onto the grace of Christ and just go, please help. We go, okay, I think I got this a little bit, right? Like, I think I can handle this. I'm going to go through all of my stuff, all of my different things before I finally go to God and I'm like, okay, God, this is all you. I think that's a common response. And he didn't do either of these. He didn't fake it, right? He didn't put on his Titus mask and assure Jesus of his steadfast faith. He also didn't try to fix it. He didn't try to go, Jesus, look, man, hold my tools, but I got this. All right, I think I can handle this. It's been a lot of years, but we're good. No, he's just honest. He just falls on his face. He says, Jesus, I need you to help. I need you to do this. And I know you're compassionate. And I know that you are God and you have the ability to. But, man, my heart is trembling with doubt. I'm afraid that what if this is just another dead end? Now, for many people, especially if we've grown up in church and if we've grown up in a church that maybe emphasized certain parts of Scripture or attributes of God over others, then this kind of relating to God is uncomfortable to us, right? Like, we're not going to go there. We're not going to question things. We're not going to doubt, like, because if we do, God might, you know, step on us like a bug. And so if we grew up that way, then this is not an option, right? And so some of us expect, okay, the natural response here is Jesus is about to slap this guy, right? Jesus is about to, like, you know, put it on him and go, man, where's your faith, dude? Right? Like, I can't even believe you. That's not what happens. Look at how Jesus responds to this. Jesus is so good. He says, it says, when Jesus saw that a crowd was quickly gathering, he rebuked the unclean spirit, saying to it, you mute and deaf spirit, I command you, come out of him and never enter him again. And it came out shrieking and throwing him into terrible convulsions. And the boy became like a corpse, so that many said, he's dead. But Jesus, taking him by the hand, raised him, and he stood up, and he was healed after that. I love that, right? Because, like, there's even the pressure of this crowd gathering around. People are gathering and going, what's Jesus going to do here? Right? What's about to go down? And all this pressure happening, and Jesus has a moment where he goes, you know what? I need to rebuke someone. But it's not going to be this dad who just cried out to me, right? It's going to be the unclean spirit, the demon that is causing these problems. He doesn't rebuke the dad. There's no semblance of Jesus being harsh with or being passive aggressive with this dad. He doesn't fault him at all for the way he responds. In fact, I think Jesus goes, thank you. I can work with that. Right? When you just, like, lay everything down in front of me, I can work with that. And so he rebukes the demon for the destruction it's causing, not the dad for the doubt that he's having. And I love that so much. He responds to the father's plea, and he addresses both of his doubts at once. He says, by the way, I can, all right, because I just did it. I can heal, and also I want to, right? I have compassion in my heart. I didn't just heal because I wanted to flex on the crowd, right? I healed because I deeply care about what's going on in your life, what's going on in your heart. In fact, I brought up the story of the leper in Mark chapter 2, but whenever that happens, when the leper says, if you're willing, you can heal me, it says that Jesus is moved in his spirits, which that phrase actually in the Greek means he was moved in his bowels, which for us, we're like, that's gross, right? What happened there, man? What did Jesus eat? But what it means is that he was moved to the deepest part of him, right? His bowels, like the most inward part of his soul, he was moved with compassion there. And I love that because that's the deepest level of compassion and love and sympathy and empathy and all those things that you can have. That's what Jesus has towards his kids who are suffering, who are doubting. That's the heart of God. And that is a wonderful thing. There's another passage in the book of Hosea, which is a very interesting book, by the way, if you haven't read it, where, again, Hosea is, he is a prophet, right? So he's speaking to, I can't remember if it's the northern kingdom or the southern kingdom, but he's speaking to the people of God, right? And he's explaining these different things, and he's speaking on behalf of God. And a lot of the book, after the first three chapters of sort of the narrative, a lot of the book is, you know, like many of the prophets, where he's warning, right? There's judgment coming. He's warning about what's happening. Hey, if you don't get this stuff together, like, come on, man, God's going to do something. This is grace. I'm giving you a chance. But it's interesting because at the end, it's sort of this climax of the book in I believe it's chapter 11, it shows God sort of with this conflict in his heart. Right, he spends all this time saying, here's all the things that I'm going to do. Like, here's these big warnings. But then he gets to a particular passage, and God stops, and he goes, but how am I supposed to give you up? How am I supposed to give you up? My heart is torn within me. I'm telling you all these things that are going to happen, but, man, I don't want that. My heart is torn within me. You are my child. Because I walked with you, Israel, out of the land of Egypt. I walked with you. I held your hand through this process. My heart is conflicted. That's the heart of God in this moment. Right? Sometimes God allows things to happen because he is sovereign and he is good, and we have to humble ourselves under that. But even in those moments, God goes, man, my heart still breaks for what your heart breaks for. I still care. Even if this is my plan, even if I know that this is going to be good, my heart still is torn within me that I have to watch you even walk this path. I love that. What a gracious God. There's no other religious system that you know, puts forth a God that's anything close to that. Right? And that's why I said, even when I was praying earlier, that we couldn't have even made this up. Right? Because all of our stories of God are about, you know, this angry God who is bloodthirsty and we have to appease his wrath and all these things, right? If you look at all the different mythologies, all the different religions, if you go back, like, this is entirely different because it's the truth, right? That we have this God who is compassionate. And when we go to him, when we're not faking it, we're not trying to fix it, we just say, look, here's what I'm going through. Here's what I need, God. Here are all my doubts. Here are all the things that are happening. Do something with it. It's like Peter talks about, cast your fears on the Lord, right? He's just like throwing them on. Like, God, just take them, right? I don't know what to do with them. They're weighing me down. And so just take them and carry them. That is what's happening in this story. And it just floors me that Jesus is so cool with that. He's just like, yes, this is what I want. This is exactly what I want from you. This is why I came, right? Jesus says, I came for the sick. I didn't come for the healthy, right? If you got life together for the most part, you're probably not going to look to me anyway, right? So if you got some stuff going on, I got you. That's what's happening in this story. We see Jesus' compassion. We also see his power and his ability completely on display. And I think that is something that we can wrestle with, even this week, right? As we go forward, as we face things, as we make mistakes, because you're going to make mistakes. We're all going to sin this week, by the way. Like, it's going to happen. It's a bummer, but it's going to happen, right? It'll probably happen today, maybe before you leave today. And so we are going to need a gracious God, right? We're going to need a God who is available, who deeply loves us, who we can cast our cares on. And so whenever you are wrestling with those things, I pray that this week that our simple prayer of faith would just be, I believe, help my unbelief. Jesus, if you can, I need you. Jesus, if you are willing, heal. And I hope that in our hearts that we picture God in that moment and all the graciousness, all the love that he has for us. Last thing I'll say is that in the Old Testament, you see there's a lot of descriptions of God, a lot of descriptions of what he has done, who he is, all of those things. But the one that comes up a lot is the passage, I believe first comes up, I think, in Exodus 6, but it says it throughout multiple different times. It's quoted in the New Testament, but it's the passage where it says that God is slow to anger, right? That he is abounding in steadfast love, slow to anger. And that, you could say, that encompasses who God is for his people, who he's always been for his people. And so, again, we see it in the Old Testament, in the book of Exodus. We see it in the life of Jesus as he helps this dad who is desperate in dealing with these things. We see it even further ahead in the New Testament in the life of Paul, and you see in Romans 7 where he's just going, look, man, I'm struggling. Why do I keep doing the things I hate? Right? Why am I continuing to doubt what God has said when I'm like the greatest missionary that's supposed to ever live? It's all throughout Scripture, and God's response in all of those moments is that he will have compassion. He will heal. He is for us. And so it's less of a practical shift as it is just a philosophy shift. Right, that we need God to get down into our hearts and change that view of him. And it's a regular thing, right? Like I said, sanctification is a process of belief moving from your head to your heart. So there's not an end point necessarily, but there are markers along the way where you can go, man, I'm so glad that God is showing me who he is, that he is changing my view of him, and that I can go to him with anything and trust that he is compassionate and that he is able. So, again, I don't know what you're going through in this season. I don't know what you're thinking about in this season. I don't know what kind of things that you are wrestling with in this season, but I pray that we can run to God with all of our honesty and that we can just throw ourselves on him and allow him to do what he does best, which is be God and be good. Let's pray. God, again, we thank you so much for this passage. God, my heart just explodes within me as I think about your compassion and your grace and your kindness and all of those things towards us that are so undeserving of it. God, you've done so much in our lives already, and yet we come up against these points where we begin to doubt again and again your ability or your compassion. And God, I pray that you would just show us time and time again that you are full of those things. You are able. You are compassionate. You are loving. You are good. You are slow to anger, God. And I pray that by your Spirit, Lord, that you would sink these truths deep into our heart. God, sink these truths deep into our heart through the power of the Holy Spirit. God, that we begin to walk different, God, with shoulders lightened, with hearts fuller, with an image of you that is more biblical and beautiful. And I pray that you would just change us continually through this process. And God, I pray for anyone here who is wrestling with things in life that they are doubting or that there just seems to be some pull and some tension in their lives. God, I just pray that you would be so kind to them. God, that you would pursue them. Lord, that you would remind them of your goodness, God, in unique ways, that you would bless them, that you would run after them, and that, God, we would just love you more because of what's happening in our lives. Just like the book of Job, God, that we can look at you and say, God, I see you so much more clearly now. God, we love you. We thank you. Fill us with your grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
All right. Thank you so much, Corey. That was great. Really appreciate you being here, as we mentioned before, and especially on holiday. Yeah, give it up. All right. So it is offering time at Third Coast Church. Yeah. All right. God loves a cheerful giver. I believe Joe said that in the Bible, said that that was in the Bible. So I just wanted to read a little bit of Exodus. This is Moses talking to the Israelites. It's different from what we talked about last week. He says, for the three annual festivals, Moses tells the people, the best of the first fruits of your ground you shall bring into the house of the Lord your God. And there's a couple of verses in the Bible that talk specifically about that. Not bringing God like what you have left over, not, you know, bringing God the sick lamb, things like that. Like, the point is to bring God our best and bring God our first. And I think that's really compelling because, you know, like a while back, our community group did Financial Peace University, and we talked about budgeting, and we certainly talked about tithing as well. And when we completed the course, Amy and I put together a budget. And when we started that budget, we started with the tithe. We started with putting tithe first, putting God first. And, you know, you see that number, and you're like, man, I really like Amazon, though. I don't know if that's gonna work out. But anyway, the point is, you know, God deserves our best. God deserves our first. God deserves, you know, the best of our produce. And I think what that does is not only does it, you know, create a discipline, create, you know, something inside of us that says, okay, we're going to tithe no matter what, the end of every week, the end of every month, whatever your rhythm is. But it also brings us closer to God because I think that it allows us to not only put our tithe first, but to put God first. And it's a reminder week to week for us. You know, we try to tithe every Sunday to put God first and to think about God before you're thinking about, you know, grocery budget, food budget, Amazon budget, things like that. And I didn't mean to point at you, by the way. Target budget for her. Anyway, so I would just encourage you to think about that today. Think about that as you consider tithing. Again, a tithe is not something you should feel like you have to do. It's something that comes from the heart. So if you're feeling compelled to do that today, there's a few different ways to give. Number one, you can go to thirdcoast.church. You can click Give Now. It's really easy to go to our website and do that directly. There's also the Tithely app, which is what Amy and I use every week. You can also take an envelope from your chair, put whatever you'd like to in there, and then drop it in that same black box on your way out the door that we mentioned earlier. So I'm going to pray for our offering real quick, and then I will hand it over to Amy for announcements. All right. Dear Lord, thank you for today. Thank you for guys like Corey who are willing to step in and just convey your message through them, Lord. We're so thankful for his discipline and his willingness to come on a holiday weekend and really just enlighten our church. And we so appreciate that. God, we ask that you take this offering into your hands. We ask that you help us to be good stewards of it. We ask that you help Third Coast to grow and to help grow our community as in followers of Christ. And Lord, we're so thankful for what you're doing here. And we ask that you help this offering to continue that effort. Amen.
All right. So just a few announcements. We have next week, we are going to be doing communion here at the church. So we encourage all of you to be here with us. And of course, anyone at home watching, I'm sure you can find some bread or other things to have to celebrate with us. But we will be going through communion next week. So we encourage everyone to be here. And the following weekend, July 18th, that Sunday, all the parents and volunteers in the children's ministry, we just ask that you stay after the service. So if you're thinking about volunteering in children's ministry, also please stay back. And we will be having just some exciting news that we're going to be sharing with you guys. And with that, here at Third Coast Church, we do not dismiss. We send you out. So happy 4th of July, and you are sent.